Films. The home of high-powered, high-voltage motion picture entertainment. With the screen's biggest spectacles, brightest stars, and boldest lineup of explosive entertainment. We're taking motion picture excitement over the edge and your box office over the top. We're Cannon Films, and we're dynamite.
Getting into the Golden and Globus era.
It's true.
And because the film that we're talking about today, The Magician of Lublin, was directed by Menahem Golan.
Yep.
And Academy Award winner Louise Fletcher. Tons of fun, wasn't it, Matthew?
Menahem Golan is not good at making movies.
Whoa! Controversial statement right off the bat.
This is melodramatic. To say the least.
Yes. So that can be fun. What, give us a little bit of backstory about the story that Menahem Golan is adapting here. It's based on a famous Jewish novel, isn't it?
Yes, it's based on the novel of the same name, which apparently the year before had won the Nobel Prize for Literature.
It did?
Yes.
Wow.
So the guy who wrote this, whose name I am blanking on.
Doesn't matter.
But his initials are IBS, like Irritable Bowel Syndrome. So this, the guy who wrote this also wrote Yentl, a bunch of these very famous...
Barbra Streisand movies?
Yeah.
Wasn't Yentl a Barbra Streisand film?
No, yeah, I mean, yeah, but I mean, he didn't write the Barbra Streisand movie. He wrote the novel the Barbra Streisand movie is based on.
Okay, sure.
I've never seen Yentl. Have you seen it?
No, I haven't. I'm a Barbra Streisand completist. All right, anyway, so this author.
So yeah, he's a very famous, well-respected, like internationally respected Jewish author who writes sort of very serious novels which with deep thematic kind of stuff going on. So The Magician of Lublin is about a womanizing magician in the 1900s. He's living in, I guess, Russian-controlled Poland, I think it is.
Sure.
At the time.
Decide which one of you, for some reason, has decided to steal. Would you please return it along with everything else you've taken from him?
Listen to my friend, I don't know what you're talking about.
Don't get smart, Middle. Everything on the table. Empty your pockets.
Was anyone else I'd break his bones?
Just a small word of warning. Anyone who says what's up goes down.
And he's going around having sex with people in every town, and this movie's played by Alan Arkin.
Did you get her address? Did you tell her I'm coming?
Tell who?
Amelia, damn you, you know who I mean.
I'm your manager, not your pimp.
You brought me all the way over here just to see that. Thanks, Al.
When I think of womanizer, I think of the sidekick from Brendan Fraser's The Mummy.
It's true. By whoever you can imagine.
Oh, Al, this brings back memories. I saw one of those in college once. I used to jog behind her for hours. I ran a marathon once and didn't even know it. You know her name?
Yeah, but I'm calling her Heidi.
So, Jeffrey Combs.
Kevin J. O'Connor.
Yeah.
And it's kind of about the fact that he doesn't really believe in, you know,
God.
The Jewish faith or yeah. God.
Can I hear it from my altar vixens, Hannah and Luya?
He's basically about at least as far as I can tell, the novel is about dealing with the idea of faith and if you do bad things, but they're not really that bad.
They're not that bad.
Yasha, I spoke to the rabbi today.
Esther, please.
No, please, Yasha, listen to me. He told me about this holy man in Eve.
Esther, why do you torture yourself? We've tried everything. Nothing works.
Yasha, we must keep trying. Yasha, I want a child so badly. I sometimes even envy those mothers whose children lay in the cemetery.
Have each other. Why isn't that enough for you?
Let me tell you a little story. God created man. Everything was going great. Then Eve came around and said, apple.
What Menahem Golan has made is a sort of histrionic kind of occasionally attempting to be sort of erotic, sexy film with Alan Arkin chewing the hell out of every piece of scenery he can get a hold of.
How do you do what you do? Show me how!
Shut your mouth! I'll shut my mouth when you shut your hole.
Vesta will never shut her hole with Yasha's in town.
Shelley Winter's shown up fat and insane as she generally did past 1970s. And a lot of nonsense.
Like to kill the bastard, to cut his stomach open, watch him dying and begging for his life.
And then what after you killed him, what? What do we do? Who takes care of us?
You? You never brought a ruble into this house. You're not even smart enough to be a good thief, are you?
The biggest complaint with this movie is that Alan Arkin did not do a lot of magic, or not enough magic for my taste.
So you were looking for a lot of scenes where he done magic stuff, right?
Well, at one point at the beginning of the movie, he gets into a bar brawl, and he just diffuses the whole situation with a little bit of magic.
It's true, he does.
So, more of that. That's my movie taste. None of this god stuff.
It's not as exciting as your cooking with Clyde the Cajun show, but at least it gives me a reason to come home.
Alright, so, I did not like this movie. Did you like this movie, Matthew?
I did not like this movie. I thought this movie was
2 hours long! Probably the longest movie we've watched yet. Which, when you're adapting a Nobel Prize winning novel, it's probably a law that you can't make it under 2 hours.
It wasn't fully 2 hours.
It was like an hour and 58 minutes.
Yeah, so we broke the law then. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, because Menahem Golan doesn't believe in your laws.
I must have been, even the TV's sweating.
Now,
we want to get as close as possible, but let's still break the law.
Yeah, exactly. Now, Golan, as we'll see later on in movies of his that I have seen, he really wants to entertain. Here, it seems very wishy-washy, and he wants to make, like, a real art house picture, but at the same time, he's kind of leaning into, as you said, more histrionic directions, and, like, it's a weird middle place that doesn't satisfy anyone.
You definitely get this sense that when he was making this movie and he like the lights came up after he saw the first cut or whatever, he was like, people are going to cry leaving this movie. It made me feel so much emotion, and you just get the sense of someone who's really, really sure that he's drawing the audience into the film and they're going to have all this emotional response to it. But this movie is kind of
boring.
Yeah,
that's its biggest problem, is that we haven't gotten to the Golan who's like throwing out all the stops just to entertain. This is a Golan who's almost playing it a little too safe for my taste.
I think he was really, but this is definitely also feels like the Golan who's trying to make really worthy art.
Yeah.
So this isn't so much like, as we say, the previous Golan film we saw, Operation Thunderbolt, he was very much of the opinion that I have to make a great movie that pays tribute to the guy who died.
Yeah, like he's a little bit too respectful with the material. When a Golan 20 years from then would have probably, I don't know, put some more explosions or some sword fights.
You say respectful, but he still has this like kind of insane way of doing things, which are just
crazy enough.
But it's not crazy. It's just like clothier, like mistaken sort of idea of how things that would be emotional and drop characters in, and certain sequences just like you're like, what is going on here?
Well, I feel it's also the kind of movie where people going to see it are like, I am aware of the novel, I probably know the novel's story, so you're being showed this information from something that you already have a base from.
It's true, but I mean, like, this movie basically, like, it's a little confusing to begin with because you don't understand who everyone is at the point. But basically, Alan Arkin is the Magician of Lublin. He travels around, he does his magic business, but he has an assistant, Magda, I think.
Who I'm like, was it his wife? No, it's not.
He also has a wife. I can't remember what his wife's name is.
You barely see her.
And he has several mistresses, and one who he particularly likes, who's this aristocratic lady with a daughter.
And another specific mistress.
Yeah.
So you gotta keep track of all of this.
You gotta keep track of all the women he's schlepping, basically.
Yeah. Schlepping.
You're a pig, Al.
Basically, it becomes a very confusing sequence where in the beginning where he's like on his cart going home or something, and he's like, oh, I'll get home by Passover or something, and but then he goes to this woman's, his assistant's house, so you're like, oh, is this actually his wife after all? And the assistant's mother is Shelley Winters, who basically more or less yanks her breasts out for Alan Arkin because she loves him so much straight away.
See how he talks to me, you see? Oh, Yasha, do you have to go? Now, couldn't you stay a few more days? I'll wait on you, hand and foot.
This is why you left the PBS pledge drive?
Well, this is something like Masterpiece Theater.
And there's a really awkward sequence where she's like to her daughter, she's like, I'm so glad you didn't cut your hair, men love long hair, now get in there and have sex with him on top of him, because then it guarantees you'll have a boy with him.
Women with long hair. Now, a gypsy gave me this amulet. I want you to wear it tonight. You understand? You get yourself pregnant, you stay on top. Then it'll be a son. It'll be a son. And he's ours forever.
Under that sensitive, caring facade, you're nothing but a man.
That's not true.
And then she sits outside in her, like, weird, fat Shelley Winters sexy underwear.
Did you know that Daddy's nurse was a fat woman who used to come to his shoe store? Well, I say, used to, because her patronage fell off one day when she came in and asked for something to make her foot look small, and I said, try your ass. She remembered.
You keep saying fat Shelley Winters.
Because I really contrast that to young Shelley Winters. I think Shelley Winters is amazing. Even when she's old, she's like, she's often great. Except usually towards the end of her career, let's say, she seemed to play lunatics every time who were just like freaking out. And then this is kind of classic. She seems like drunk and mad the whole time. Except you also have the joy of seeing her in sort of sexy underwear peeking on her daughter having sex with Alan Arkin.
Which is, and you just know, when you think of sex symbol, you think of Alan Arkin, don't
it,
you?
It is true. It's just, you're kind of like, what? At that point, I was just like, what is really going on in this movie? I don't understand.
And then they introduce the idea that Alan Arkin really wants to fly.
Yeah, he's kind of like, if Jewish people could just fly, everything would be okay.
Is that the truth? Like,
I honestly don't know, but this is confusing because he's obsessed with flying.
He really wants to fly, and he doesn't. You know, for a guy that they show over and over again knowing how to break things really easily, yeah. Like at one point someone brings him a lock and he's like, I built this just so you couldn't beat it. And Alan Arkin beats it in like 2 minutes blindfolded.
Yeah.
Later on, his plan for flying is just kind of making wings and jumping off of something.
Yeah,
like,
laughing.
Yeah, that's all he's got.
The centerpiece of this movie is that he's in Warsaw or whatever, and he really, really loves this. He loves this aristocratic lady.
Even though he's married to someone else.
Even though he's married to someone else, he really, I mean, he's kind of a dick.
He's a huge dick.
And yet I read them. You've been waiting patiently for someone to return from a long journey. You know this person can change your life, that he can free you from boredom, from loneliness. Even the wealth of your old nobleman cannot do that for you. The man of mystery you've been waiting for has never stopped thinking about you, aching to see you.
Take me out here.
Hi, Mama.
Now.
Alina, where are you going?
The secret messages of my soul will follow you all the way home.
Oh, Marcy, calm down. Men will look at anything.
And she has a daughter who's like sick, she's consumptive or whatever, she has a cough basically, and she's like, look, my husband's dead or whatever, I need a rich man so my daughter can get taken to Italy and all that, what are you really doing in your life? So he sort of basically works it, what he's going to do is, he's going to have a big show
where he's going to fly.
He's going to fly, even though at no point has he tested his flying machine
or anything. At no point has anyone been like, you can do another trick. Like, you can do a whole bunch of crazy bullshit.
Yeah.
So you don't have to fly.
Yeah, but he's
like, I'm gonna fucking show God. Where does it say in the Bible that God is like fucking flying around and doing stuff like that? I don't think it shows it anywhere.
It's like the one thing that God says in the Bible you humans can't do.
Fly.
It's like, thou shalt not fly.
Thou shalt not kill. Thou shalt right after.
Thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's birds.
Yeah, that's right.
Because they fly. Basically, God has a real hate on for flying things. I remember the bird that told Adam and Eve to eat the winged apple.
The winged apple. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
That's from the tree with wings. That was flying around.
That must be the Wright brother translation of the Bible.
Yes, yes.
She won't live through the shock. She'll flicker out like a candle.
What do you want for my life? You want me to stay the little Jew magician from Lublin forever? I want Paris walls. I want London. I'm going to fly over the great rooftops of the world. I won't be held back.
Marcy, you're assuming he can actually do this. You know the Bundy legacy? What they don't finish in 30 seconds, they never finish.
So he's obsessed with having the show. And then I guess off the back of that, escaping with that aristocratic lady or something?
Yeah, and at the same time, his assistant is very jealous of him.
So what's the first thing the assistant does? The first thing the assistant does
It changes his locks when he does an underwater magic trick. So it takes him longer to escape and he could have drowned.
But then he still doesn't fire her for some reason.
No, even though she fucking tried to kill him.
And she kept like feeding him and stuff, and I was like, sure that she was trying to poison him, but that never comes up.
No.
She was telling the monkey, because there's a monkey in this movie.
You know, you gotta shake it up when you got a little bit of drama. Yeah. Menahem Golan is like, put a monkey in there.
Yeah, put
and
a monkey
in there.
And
then you cut away to it.
That's one desperate little chimp, huh?
Basically what happens is, one of the women he was having sex with in the previous town, on the day he has to do his big show, she comes back into his life. And he's like, what? And she's like,
I'm gonna go to some country where they're gonna pimp me out.
Yeah, she
and Alan Arkin's like, don't go there, they're gonna pimp you out.
Yeah, she's like, duh, I'm gonna go to Buenos Aires in America. And he's like, Buenos Aires isn't in America, it's in South America. Did they say South America? He's not even that clear with her.
I don't know, somehow I don't trust him.
He's from America like I'm from China.
You know him?
I don't have to know him. You know what a pimp is? He'll drag you away somewhere and put you in a whorehouse. He knows your husband in America like I know the Tsar's father.
What can I do, Yasha? I can find a job. He says he'll put me up in his sister's house.
She's his sister like I'm your uncle. She's a madam. They will split the profits. They'll sell you somewhere, God knows where, maybe Buenos Aires, then you'll rot there.
Just slide down that evolutionary scale.
Buenos Aires is the city they mentioned in America.
Buenos Aires is not in America, stupid. These people prey on women like you. They're dealers in human flesh, in women. They're white slavers. The newspapers are full of it. Get out of there quick, or you'll end up a whore in Buenos Aires.
Here, take it. From me to you, it's yours. It's hardly been used. I should have known there was something up.
All that knowledge, and you sell shoes.
Hey, Michelangelo was just a painter, but he did other stuff too.
He realizes the only way that he can stop her doing this is by doing magic tricks for her pimp,
yep,
I guess,
that's
which
right.
Doesn't even make any sense. So he spends all this time doing magic tricks and doesn't show up for his
big show.
So then he goes to the empty arena,
yeah,
where they've smashed up his bird costume. He yells at the
wouldn't have worked anywhere
audience that aren't there. Then when does he get home?
It doesn't. Or, does, no, because what happens is, he finds out that the woman who he did the magic tricks for, and that he paid the pimp off, that he was tricked, and that it was all a con.
Now, yeah, because they're all in bed together or something.
Yeah, so this is the thing. Alan Arkin gets punished for trying to save a woman's life.
It's true.
That is what the crux of the film is. Now, whether Alan Arkin is a cheating asshole, which he is,
mm-hmm,
but that's not what the film punishes him for.
No.
It punishes it for him missing his big,
to try and save someone.
Yes.
So
what happens is he then goes to the aristocrat's house that he gave his money to because he wants to steal it back from him. And in the process, he starts to hallucinate.
Yeah, he sees him as if he's been murdered.
Yep.
And then
he jumps out a window.
And he uses his cape.
Yep.
To fly, I guess. We're supposed to be like, oh, he actually is flying. He's not. He's just falling slightly more slowly. He's still basically fucks his leg up in the process.
Yes, when he hits the ground, and then his assistant hung herself.
No, he comes home to a shocking sequence, which is like all the animals have been murdered by the assistant.
That's
and
right.
Then she's wearing clown makeup with all her hair cut short, hanging there. It's kind of freaky, actually. And he's like, dang!
So then he makes the decision that he will...
This decision is like... If we were to ask people to guess what he decides to do at this point, I guarantee you no one could ever guess.
Okay, let's take some guesses. If someone just told you what was going to happen, would it tie into flying? Like, would he jump off of something wanting to fly?
Would he just, you know, for example, would he just go home to his wife and be like, oh,
settle
well,
down?
Be like, I guess that's...
You know, I made some mistakes and it's blown up in my face, but I've learned from those mistakes and I'll be a better person.
You know, would you try and, like... You know, get the aristocrats still be with him and stuff. Mm-hmm. I mean, would he get arrested maybe or something because he tried to? No.
No.
Here's what he has to do.
He goes back to his home village.
Goes back to his home village. He builds himself a doorless kind of shed.
Not even a, but it was brick.
With brick.
So he can't get out.
And then he lives there.
And you find this acceptable? I'm sorry, honey, I didn't hear you. I was just thinking of killing myself.
He just lives.
We don't know how long, do we?
We have no idea how long.
It doesn't feel like that long.
But he has like a big beard and stuff. And he just lives in a dark brick hole, basically.
How much shit is in that hole?
Because he must be shitting there.
Yeah.
And he remembers the film for the sequence. He's like, oh, I remember when I shagged that belt. Remember when I shagged her? Remember when I shagged her? Remember when she died? And he remembers that for a while. And then apparently, so we can tell, what's been happening is people have been coming up to the little window in his shed and not being like, oh, God, oh, my God. Are you shitting in there, mate? Are you
going to do some magic for me or...
For company? Who the hell would want to come over here?
You know, what about this
and
flying
thing? And then
he,
like, oh, and then he gives people,
advice?
Advice and stuff, right? He's like,
why would I want his fucking advice?
You live in a fucking brick house, mate.
What
advice can you give me? He's like, it doesn't make any sense.
So, like, the rich aristocrat comes and sees him?
No. We have to point out that the first thing happens is the guy who tried to set up the whole show for him, everything comes over, right? And he's like, oh, I heard that you were giving it advice and you're the, the seer or the... or whatever, of the town of Lublin, you know, and he's like...
You narcissistic asshole. No. Why does it always have to be about
and
you?
And he comes in and he goes, look, I mean, I've done a lot of things in my life. I've put on some shows with bad comedians and magicians and all that, and I'm getting old, and I'm scared. I'm scared. This is literally what, like, the magician goes. He goes, ah, you know, if God exists, you know, and if he doesn't exist, you know, you should respect him. And the guy goes... Thanks, you've really helped me. And you're like, that's the shittest advice ever. Go with God, my son. It's like the most boring fucking...
I think he does, yes. But if he doesn't, Jacob, you must still behave as if he does.
Thank you, Asher. Thank you for those beautiful words. But then, you were always very good.
Tell it, Reverend Al!
So when you were a kid, did you go to church?
I've been to church maybe a couple of times.
So, but your parents weren't religious?
My parents weren't religious.
So you never had to go to church and ask, like, advice from a preacher or anything?
I think I went to, like, Sunday school and stuff when I was a little kid and things. I mean, I think my mum, for grandparents' reasons and stuff, tried to keep us involved when we were young, but I mean, there was, like...
It's boring.
Who gives a shit? She doesn't care, so, like...
Yeah, okay. So you've never gotten advice from a priest. Because from everything I can see, that's usually the kind of advice they give, which is, like... You know, God will show the way.
And you're like, that's not actual help.
That's not advice.
Like, I mean, is that honestly? It's like people are like, well, he lives in a wee brick house. He must be right, you know? Like, because after all, Big Bad Wolf came. Couldn't you fucking blow it down? Because remember that pig?
There's another seer over there that's in a straw house.
This is no good.
No good.
It's no good.
You want the brick house, man.
You want the brick house, man, yeah.
And then who else does he see? And then he sees the aristocrat lady.
So he sees the aristocrat lady and she's like, my daughter's in Italy now, mad to the count. Everyone's pretty good. Smell you later.
Smell you later. And by that I mean smell you. It smells like shit.
The short time I knew you, Yasha, was the happiest time of my life. Can you forgive me?
There's nothing to forgive.
am the Countess Zhursky. After you left me, I was alone. I had to take care of Helena. She's in a sanatorium now in Italy. I had to tell her what has happened to you. It was her idea that I come and see you. She wanted to come. But the doctor said, pray for me, Yasha.
And you for me?
We heard about your little loss. We know you'll make it through. Because thankfully the part they took was of no use to you.
And then...
Is it just Shelley Winter's mom?
So basically a woman comes over and she's like, oh, my daughter died and you should, say some stuff. And he's like, oh, that's really bad. No, then she's like, psych, it's me, Shelley Winters. Fine old.
She's like, ah!
She's basically ah! And then she gets her dumb son and his pals.
What does he have hanging from his face?
He's just dribbling the whole time. And he just like smashes up the brick house because they were like,
you mean a wolf, right?
Yes.
What's a wolf? We're gonna get a wolf and we're gonna get some pegs. And the wolf and the pegs are going to blow it down.
Yes.
All right.
Pegs don't do any blowing.
No, they don't.
They just live in the house.
They just live in the house.
So, they smash up the house, but when the house is all smashed up, they look there.
And he's gone.
And he's gone. And
at this point, they look at the house, and they're like, he's gone. And they hear geese, and they look up. And they assume that he turned into a geese? Wouldn't they look across the way to see if Alan Arkin is just running across?
They were like, wait, he was a magician, right? So he's probably pretty good at disappearing and stuff.
Yeah, like, I built this house. Like, I built an exit hatch. Instead, they look at the geese and they yell his name as if finally he turned into a geese and flew away.
Yeah, they just all assume he turned into a geese. And I think you're supposed to be like, you're honestly supposed to be like...
He finally reached the salvation he desired.
He did turn into a geese and then cry and stuff or whatever. And as far as I know, the original book, it's just he goes back to the village and he lives in penance in his little...
Oh, is that what it is?
Yeah, he just... The idea is just that if... The idea of the book, as far as I can tell, is that if you live a life where you don't care about other people and just do whatever you feel like, eventually it'll come back and bite you in the ass. Mm-hmm. Do you know what I mean? Whereas the film is kind of like a bunch of stuff happens, then he tries to do a good thing, then he lives in a brick house for a while full of shit, and then
we're just assuming it's full of shit. Maybe he built like a drainage system or
like, you know, that little hatch.
He just threw the shit out.
No, he just pokes his ass out and just poos over the ends.
That's not funny for anyone else because they don't know how little the hatch is.
He pokes his...
people put their mouth in when they want to talk to him.
Yeah, he just pokes his wee bum out. To be Alan Arkin bum.
Yeah. Alright.
The funniest thing with the ending is that everybody important in his life came in the same afternoon.
Yes, that's
he'd
true.
He'd been there for 2 years and one afternoon...
Does it say how long he's been there?
I mean, it doesn't...
I assume it's been like a week.
I don't know. I've just been assuming it's been a few years. I don't know why.
Okay.
But basically...
What a fucking asshole. His wife is literally down the way. She could have been like, why don't you just stay at home and I just lock you in when you finish your chores?
Yeah.
You asshole.
Like, just you know, go back to normal, you know, like...
Yeah. Yeah, penance as in, like, you do what you're supposed to do. Instead of being a big baby and being the center of attention...
Yeah.
And you suddenly think you can give out advice...
Yeah, go with God. It's not really helpful in this point. I'm just asking you exactly how I should cook this bacon. Go with God.
Go with God. God will show you the way. I just got food poisoning, you fucker. Those pigs that built the house, they were all gamey. I should not have cooked them that way.
Exactly.
You got them.
Come to a guy in a fucking brick house for your information.
Did you see that wolf? That wolf is over there.
Okay, so... This movie's bad.
Oh, so bad.
I mean, and it's not even like bad
in a fun way
or in an interesting way.
No,
it's just kind of like The Magician of Lublin. He was trying to make something arty. So, like, the thing I didn't mention is supposedly the theme song is by Kate Bush. I don't remember a vocal theme song in this movie.
I don't know.
At the beginning, was there singing? I don't even remember.
Maybe in the over the end credits, but by the time those credits popped up, I'm like, done. We're done.
And I listened to the song. It's not very good. It's definitely not our best work.
Really?
Which is why she's never released it ever again. There's really nothing to this movie. Canon, canon?
No.
Nope. Nah, no reason.
Yep. I'm recommending a movie that another letter writer. Oh, there's so much backstory and continuity now. Cam Maitland. We read his letter 3 episodes ago. He actually asked a question at the end of the letter, which was, what is that giallo that you talked about that took place in Montreal? I really want to know what it is. And that giallo is called Shadows in an Empty Room, a.k.a. Blazing Magnums. Very different titles.
It's a pretty good name.
It's not really a giallo. It was sold that way. It's mostly a Eurocrime film where Stuart Whitman... Do you know who Stuart Whitman is?
No.
Yeah, he's a name. It's a name I recognize, but I don't know his face. I'm not gonna do any research to see what he's in. Plays a cop that comes to an Ottawa cop that comes to Montreal to solve the murder of his sister. And in that time, he gets in one of the craziest car chases I have ever seen. He fights 3 transvestites, and he does a lot of other cool stuff. And Martin Landau's in the movie too. I highly recommend it. It's one of those movies that I saw years ago at a film festival in a retro screening, and that it was recently released by Kino Lorber and Scorpion Releasing in an incredibly expensive Blu-ray. And I watched it, and it lived up and surpassed my memories of it. It ends with a helicopter being shot out of the sky and exploding when it hits the ground. So, once again, that's Shadows in an Empty Room, a.k.a. Blazing Magnums. Matthew has nothing to say because he hasn't seen this.
Wait, and it's a giallo?
It's, yeah, because a guy's kind of, there's like 3 kind of giallo murders in it. I'd like to point out that last week I started recommending Knock Off, and then you took over and you ended it with, that's my recommendation, you fucking son of a bitch.
Did I have 2 recommendations last week after all?
I said Knock Off, and then you completely hijacked it. That's what happens when I recommend a movie you've seen.
So wait, what did you just recommend?
It's called Shadows in an Empty Room, a.k.a. Blazing Magnums.
Okay, Blazing Magnums.
Yeah, Blazing Magnum.
Blazing Magnum.
Yeah,
sure. Okay.
It's not like a number of dicks firing, it's just one dick.
Wait, well, why dicks?
Magnum condoms? Come on, man. I know. Okay. Yeah.
The Illusion I Recommend is the Sylvain Chomet film from 2010. It's a French Scottish animation.
Oh, that's why you recommend it.
And it's basically based on Jacques Tati's kind of unmade movie, I guess, unmade script about a sad magician, basically, who he sort of exists in this world, sort of in the 50s, where like people don't care about magicians and stuff anymore. And he moves to the UK, he ends up in Scotland, he meets a young woman who's impressed by his magic, and it's kind of all about his sort of, you know, that magicians don't create real magic and all that. And it's very, very magical. Sad, and it's beautifully made. It's
magical, if you will.
Fuck. The point I'm making is...
Whoa!
Try to get to somewhere real here, Justin.
Okay, I'm sorry.
The place I'm going to do is, it's all set in Edinburgh. Well, not all of it's Edinburgh, but it's mostly set in Edinburgh. All streets that I remember and stuff. Huh. When I watched it, I basically cried from the beginning until the end.
Was it just because it's from a place of nostalgia?
Well, just like something about the way that it, like, it's sad in the first place, and kind of like the places and stuff. It's a city which I only lived in for a while, and I'll probably never live in again. I don't see any reason and stuff, and I just find it very emotional. But it's a beautiful movie. I really enjoyed it. If you're looking for something kind of really sad and beautiful, and yes, magical, my recommendation, of course, is Blazing Magnum.
My name is Justin DeClue.
I was Matthew Kumar.
Thanks for listening.